What happened to all the fun in the world?
Larry's not with us anymore. He went on, you know.
Yeah.
Yeah. He bit the big one. Yeah. Well, he's got his own little piece of heaven now.
Welcome once again to Crazy Comics and Stories.
You don't know where to go to, why don't you go where fiction sits?
Putting on the Ritz! Sorry, Chris is calling me. Go on, I'll catch up. I can't talk now, I'm podcasting. Get out with him again. Okay, sorry.
It's me, your charming and delightful old Uncle Rat Bastard. And at the other end of the series of tubes and spooky wires.
Oh, sorry, that's Holly calling me. Hang on. Holly, I can't talk. I'm podcasting. Yeah, that's right, with him. Okay, sorry. Go ahead.
It's Joe Scary Rider. How you doing today, Joe?
I am real tired of candy corn. I am sure glad it's almost done with, you know?
You know what tomorrow is, don't you?
Nope.
Tomorrow's the best day of the year.
What day is that?
Half-price candy day.
Oh. I didn't know if you put the candy corns head-to-head that you could actually make candy corn on the cob.
That's good, because nobody eats candy corn. I don't care what anyone says. No one actually eats candy corn. Now, me, I eat circus peanuts. Even though people say they're a terrible candy, those people are... It's lies and fiction. Fictional lies. Circus peanuts, one of the greatest candies ever. Candy corn, no one likes it. No one eats it. Don't know why they make it. Just... There's a comedian who once said that they just made a batch of candy corn in, like, 1904. And when people throw it out, the company goes through the dumpsters, gets it all back, puts it in bags, sells it again. I believe that.
If it's like anything like regular corn, it just goes through your system undigested. So that there could be truth to that.
But nope, it's Halloween! And we're not going to talk about scary comics. Although, there were some comics that scared the shit out of me when I was a kid we're going to talk about.
We are?
Yes!
Well, I thought we were going to talk about fun comics.
We will, but first...
Because I don't have any scary comics ready.
Oh, these comics probably scared you, Joe.
I don't know.
Jack Chick of Chick Publications passed away. Joe, do you know who Jack Chick was? He was 90.
At the time, I didn't, but I come to realize he used to leave all those goofy... religious pamphlets on the bus that I would pick up just because they were in comic book form, and I figured, well, what the hell, I might as well read it in comic. And thanks to Jack, I figured when I die that my entire life I would stand in front of God and everybody, you know, be it family, friends, archangels, Jesus, Mary, the apostles, and God would put my life on a big screen television.
A huge TV.
And I would review every single thing I even did, which as a kid reading this, I thought, well, you know, the first couple of years were going to be boring because I was a kid and not doing much. And is he really going to replay every time I had diarrhea on the crapper? And I better shape up and not do those things that, you know, I do a lot now because I spend a lot of time at home. So... Yeah, I do recall. I didn't realize who it was when he originally died, but like I said, I used to collect all the books, little pamphlets he would put out. I never mailed away for any, but you know, that's because I was a comic book guy. I had to have the complete collection.
Me, when I was a kid, I grew up, you know, in a town of 250 people. And there were times when those little comics would be at school. There were times they would be at church. And the way you got them was that people would mail away for them, and they would get, like, bundles of 25 or 50 or whatever to leave around to, you know, tell people about the good news, that communism is evil, that rock and roll is Satan's music.
You're going to hell. Don't even deny it. You're there.
That Catholics,
a box waiting and everything.
Catholics are the tools of Satan.
We are. It's true.
What the flame of blue hell? Someone is calling me.
Well, why not? Everybody's been calling me.
I'm going to be declining that call because I don't know who it is.
Yeah, that's kind of how I do it. If I don't recognize the number, hey, leave a message or go to hell. Which, speaking of which, it kind of brings us back to what we were talking about. I'm on the highway to hell.
There we go.
I'm on the
I read those as a kid.
Hell.
And one of the things about them that really creeped me out was that everything was controlled by Satan. TV, music, all this stuff. And I've talked in the past, I was a really sensitive little kid. I couldn't even watch Godzilla movies. They scared me too much. Reading these comics, I was petrified. You know, every time I took a bath, it's going to be up on the big screen. People are going to see me without my clothes. All of this, and it just, I'm not going to say it traumatized me, but it really, really messed me up. That was the first time I heard about Catholicism, first time I heard about homosexuality, first time I heard about all sorts of things. And then by the time I was a teenager and I knew a little more about Jack Chick and I knew a little more about the John Birch Society, which he wasn't a part of, but he kind of agreed with, and on and on and on, the more it's like, yeah, this guy's a nut job. When I was on Genie, which was an early nationwide internet bulletin board, much like CompuServe or Prodigy or AOL, a number of comic creators became fascinated with him, including Peter David and Neil Gaiman, and just started researching into him and where did he come from. And you know, a lot of artists talked about how he used tons of swipes for his art. And he was, you go to the website, he's still selling those little tracks. They're exactly the same. He hasn't updated them. They still put out more. And he passed away at 93. For, you know, hopefully he's down in wherever you go when you pass away and being told, messed up.
He's got to sit naked in front of everybody, his friends, asking God and Jesus and Mary and Allah and Buddha and all those fun guys, Cthulhu, and review his life. And I also thought, like, when I was sleeping, that had to be boring.
Yeah.
Can we fast forward this part?
No.
But there was another death this week that was not funny.
Corey, you watch Walking Dead, didn't you?
Why, yes, I did.
You know what Glenn's favorite restaurant is?
Popeyes.
Bingo!
Did you see the ratings for
that? I saw you posted them, yeah.
Yeah, it was eye-popping.
And what's really eye-popping is all the family groups, oh my God, I can't believe it did that. And I'm like, really? Why are you letting your kids watch this?
That was the thing that got me. There were so many people, I'm never watching this again. It's bad. You know, my kids were traumatized. Do you not see where it says TVMA? Do you not see where it has the warning at the beginning that says graphic violence? There are times when I just wonder if these people are just, you know, they just, it's one of my son's friends. I don't know if we could call them really friends. He doesn't remember them at all, but they were a next door neighbor, and it was a single mom with three kids, and the oldest kid was about my son's age, and his name, I swear I am not making this up, Joe. His name was Skittles. And there was one time Mike came in and said, can I eat it over at Skittles' house tonight? And I said, yeah, sure, why didn't you? That's great. And he came back, you know, a few hours later before bedtime, and he said, oh, we had a lot of fun, you know, we had this, and we watched Terminator 2. He was like 7. So I sit down with him and we discuss violence and we discuss, you know, and all the stuff that you should have told a child when they're going to watch an R-rated movie. Then the next day when I saw the mom, I said, when my son's over, could you please do me a favor and not watch R-rated movies when he's there? Oh, you know, the kids really wanted to see it, and there's nothing bad in it. And I said, yes, there is. There's a lot of violence. There's a lot of death. And I just don't want to, you know, I'm his dad, and I kind of want to have a little control over what he watches. So, you know.
No.
But, you know, I didn't let him watch, you know, Dawn of the Dead when he was 12. I waited until he was 13 when it's important to learn about them all.
What did we used to say? There was a time and a place for everything. It's called college.
That's right.
Words of wisdom here from your old friends at Crazy Comics.
But you had an article you wanted to talk about.
Well, no, you said there was another death.
Oh, that's right. Over the weekend...
This is almost sad
news. This one hurt. This one hurt. And I don't want to do the sad news because we kind of use that for, you know, sarcasm.
Oh.
Steve Dillon, who was the artist on Preacher and Punisher, and back in the 80s, he did a lot of work with 2000 AD, a lot of Judge Dredd stories, passed away. He was 54. They have not talked about the cause. There are some people who say who said he's been sick for a while. There were others who were said that they thought he was sick, but maybe he got better. But it really came out of left field. And the thing that was fascinating to me is, there are times when something happens and that's all you see on your Facebook. Like, you know, during the debate, boom, that's all I saw. Walking Dead finale, boom. Cubs winning, boom. It was the Cubs won, the Cubs are going in the World Series. And now all of a sudden, Steve Dillon passed and that's all I saw. And it was artists talking about how generous he'd been. Other people talking about how much they loved his art. A lot of people talking about his work with Garth Ennis on Preacher and Punisher. And it really kind of hit me. It's not like I knew him or I knew anything about him other than his art. And I always enjoyed his art. I thought that Marvel did a good thing. They tried him on a couple superhero books and then said, no, he needs to be on the more realistic stuff. Because much like Kevin Maguire, his strength is facial expression.
And there was the one Spider-Man book where it was just him and Aunt May going to visit Uncle Ben's grave. That worked, because like you said, that was realistic. There wasn't a lot of superhero with it. And I can't remember which issue number it was. It was before, I don't know, I'll find it while you talk.
I really didn't have much more to say other than if you've not seen Steve Dillon's work. His work on Preacher and Punisher, both with Garth Ennis, are amazing because he was able to convey so much with facial expression that the writer didn't have to do a lot of caption, didn't have to do a lot of dialogue to show the emotion. The emotion was all there in the character. And the characters he created with Ennis are just iconic. You know, all the characters in Preacher, you see them, they're individual, you know them just by how they're drawn. Punisher, he and Garth Ennis, just phenomenal work. And he was currently working on Punisher, and he's going to be missed. And he left a lot of art behind. And I'm pretty bummed about it.
It is kind of Avenging Spider-Man. That was his number 11. If I recall that, that's where he did a single issue there. Because he did a couple issues there in the run. But 11 is where Peter and Aunt May were talking, and they go out to visit Uncle Ben's grave. And really worth picking up to get an idea what his non-preacher, non-Punisher stuff was like. And again, not a lot of superheroes. It was actually a really good slice of life one. And they're running about cover price on eBay if you want to check it out. I think it's kind of ironic because you got a guy like the first guy we were talking about who, you know, was trying his best to scare Jesus and God and everybody versus somebody who worked on Preacher. And I wonder if when Steve gets to wherever he's going, God's going to sit down and go, hey, let's talk a bit about this Preacher stuff you and Ennis did. It's funny, kind of an interesting dichotomy. We need some fun around here.
Yes.
A couple of weeks ago, mid-October, there was a column by Jim McQuarrie, In Defense of Fun. This was on AtomicJunkShop.com. And in it, he goes to task about an article or something that Dan, how do you say his last name? Didio talked about. And he's basically saying, I got to see if I can find the quote here. Dan famously declared that heroes can't be happy and then killed off all the characters who violated that edict. Ralph and Sue, Dibney, you know, and a lot of this also, you know, you have that type of attitude, you know, where everything's got to be dark and gritty, and you see it in the Zack Snyder's film where they're paralyzed with fear that someone's going to start going na 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 na.
They're paralyzed with fear that somebody will turn on a light
or turn on the holy verb, Batman, and they want to make Batman so dark that no one will ever remember the goofy version. But what he talks about is that it doesn't have to be that way, because there's a lot of series that aren't, well, dark and gritty. They're actually fun. And I used to remember back when I had my comic shop, is people would come in and they'd say, well, what series do you read? Well, I read this one. Or what do you think about it? Well, it's fun. And as soon as I said fun, you could see the light in their eye go off and they just kind of put it back on the shelf. Didn't matter what I described as fun. It could have been like a Archie versus Punisher, or it could have been like a Spawn, or it could have been the raunchiest Vertigo title out. As soon as I said it was fun, maybe I should have said I enjoy it, but boy, fun was just the kiss of death for a comic book in the 90s. And a lot of that's changing now. And Dan goes on, or Jim goes on, to talk about some of the titles that he likes that are fun. But I was just curious, Corey, what was your take on that? Comic characters can't be happy. They have to be miserable, dark and gritty.
I think it shows a problem editorially if an editor believes that. Because what you need in a story, you need light moments and dark moments. You look at any good movie, it's got more than just one emotion. Aliens. I remember when I saw Aliens in the theater, it was one of those where at the end of it, my forearms hurt, and I realized this because I'd actually been gripping the armrests of my theater seat so hard for the whole time. But what do people remember? They remember the funny bits. Yes, it's one of the most action-packed films ever. It's got a lot of tense moments. It's got a lot of scary moments. But what do people remember? People remember the funny lines. Game over, man! Game over! That sort of thing.
Was actually an improv, which a lot of people don't realize. They just decided to keep it. Same thing like in The Godfather, you know. Leave the gun. Take the cannoli. Just an improv. You know, kind of a fun little line in the middle of a big tragedy in the storyline.
You have to relieve the tension. And if you look at your life, you have moments that are sad, you have moments that are scary, you have moments that are funny. You have to have, the more emotion you put into a story, the better. I think a lot of the problem is with some editors, they're like, no, we we don't want to be silly. We don't want to be goofy. This is serious shit. God damn it, Batman is serious all the time. And it's one of the reasons why I don't like certain eras of Batman when it's everything must be dark.
I'm Batman. Itself was an improv.
Yeah.
Michael Keaton's line was supposed to be, I'm the Dark Knight, and he just pulled him forward and said, I'm Batman, which is now iconic, you know?
Yeah.
See, you got to make this shit up.
Well, sometimes you got to make it up. Sometimes you just, no, that's not a good idea.
Jim goes on to list titles that he thinks are fun, of some of his few favorite fun titles. And I thought, I'm going to list what he lists real quick, and then Corey and I are going to do a round robin of just titles that we think are fun and why we think they're fun. And I hope none of these tread on what you have down in the list. His list seemed to be really DC Marvel-centric. The first one he had was the classic Plop from the 70s, which was kind of, I don't know how you would call it. It was kind of like a Kurtzman-era Mad in comic book form.
It wasn't that good.
Saying it's that good. It seems that's where it's taking its inspiration from.
You could say that because Joe Orlando worked on it. A lot of it was Sergio. They wanted Sergio to do a comic. And also in some of their horror books, they were doing lighter-hearted stories. Matter of fact, there are issues of Plop that reprinted stories from the horror, or what DC called mystery, books.
So more of a blend of comedy and horror.
And if you read Plop, it's horror comedy.
The next one he lists is Inferior 5.
Ugh.
Well, he likes it. You know, again, he might be... I tried reading Inferior 5, and I just didn't get it. And he says the smart part of the comic is that they're children of the Earth's greatest heroes. They're expected to step up, carry on the legacy, but they know or at least believe they haven't got their goods.
It just wasn't funny.
Angel and the Ape. Again, and this is another point. What one person thinks funny, another person may not. He puts down Angel and the Ape. He mentions Marvel's Not Brand Eck.
Not Brand Eck was as good a parody series as you could probably get from Marvel. It has not aged well. That one was very much, you know, trying to do what Kurtzman did. I love Jack Kirby. I love him a lot. I think he can be funny. But a lot of the stuff he and Stan did in Not Brand Eck was more... Joe, do you remember all those movies like Date Movie and Superhero Movie and Disaster Movie and...
Oh, Scary Movie, yeah.
Yeah, where it's, hey, look, you know this. Isn't that funny? Not Brand Eck felt a lot of the same way as, you know what this is, we're making a joke about it, without actually making a joke.
The first one he mentions here that's not a Marvel or DC is E-Man. He mentions the original Carlton run was more of a goofy comic book, whereas when First Comic revived it in the 80s when I caught on, it was more satirical.
Yeah.
And I enjoyed that one. I remember that one coming out. Corey and I both, I think, we remember fondly the Justice League, the blah-ha-ha-ha era.
That was amazing.
That's one of those series that I don't have in my collection, and I've got to figure out if they came out with an omnibus of it, I'd be all over it. I'll just have to figure out a way to pick them up. They don't seem to be tremendously collectible, so they should be easy to pick up. Captain Carrot and His Amazing Zoo Crew. I remember enjoying the original run. I think I picked up the showcase a while back, so I can at least read it if I want. One we've talked about, or I should say Corey's talked about a lot, because he definitely knows more about it than I do, Howard the Duck.
Oh, yeah.
Untold Tales of Spider-Man. Now, here he's talking more just a superhero story, but it was stories that were, how would you say, mixed in between the original Spider-Man stories from the 60s, just telling stories that never really were told. This was in the height of the 90s. Comics were grim and gritty, and the speculator market was crazy, and along comes Marvel doing Untold Tales of Spider-Man for 99 cents. There were a few good ones in there, but nothing really, I don't know. I don't know if you'd call it fun. Spider-Girl, he mentions, writer Tom DeFalco. And I think that one's almost like the Supergirl one. You know, Spider-Girl liked being Spider-Girl, and it showed at least what little of the series I read.
And it was a lot like, Silver Age Marvel through Tom DeFalco's, kind of like, here's the best way to put it. Joe, you remember old copy machines, right? You take a paper, you put it down, you make a copy, and then you take that copy and you make another copy. And by the time you get to the third copy, you can still make out what it is. And it's still, you know, red legible, but it's not as crisp. And
I just got a text from the Xerox Corporation. Thank you for calling it copier and not Xerox machine.
That's kind of how Spider-Girl always felt to me. That's kind of how a lot of Tom DeFalco stuff always feels to me. It's like third generation Stan Lee. And I'm not saying that to be mean. It's just what he did.
Not everything is for everybody. The last two he has down is Leave It to Chance, which I haven't read in a long time, but I enjoyed it. If I recall it right, the main character was just a young sorceress, or she was just mixed into this world she didn't really know, but she wanted to.
Yep.
I know I've got the four hardcovers downstairs. And the final one he mentions, which I've raved on and on, Astro City. A good example, like Corey said, of there's serious stuff going on, but there's some fun going on as well. And what I love about it is you can go and reread it and you'll catch things that, you know, clues that were laid out long time ago that come to fruition in the current story you're reading. So I tasked Mr. Strode and myself with a bit of homework for your amusement.
Homework?
Homework!
I gotta do homework!
Now you know how I feel.
God.
I thought we could list like five series, and I tried to stay away from Marvel DC, although you'll see I failed in a few instances, that we thought were fun.
Not only that, I don't know about...
If you think they're fun, they're also worth you picking up.
I only chose currently running comics.
I have one that is, and the other ones are not. So you can dig a few back issues. Well, this will be interesting. I will start with my first pick, Megaton Man by Donald Simpson. And I'm talking the original run from 84 to 86. Megaton Man is a parody of almost all the bad stuff that you could think of in terms of comics. And Don just did a fantastic job, not only with the art, but with the storylines just being so ridiculous. You would think that Trent Flug is just another hulking goggled reporter, but as Megaton Man, he's a hulking goggled superhero. See the difference, right?
Yes.
And it's not all fighting supervillains. He has a sensitive, romantic side. For example, his costume apparently doesn't hide any everything, so he kind of likes to hide things. And you know, he has an impossible crush on ace reporter Pamela Jointly. Despite his sensitive cries of, woo, Pamela, baby, she's somehow convinced that Trent's a jerk. I enjoyed this series when it first came out, and this is a case of when a series was super hot when it first came out, and it's since cooled to the point where you could probably find these in quarter boxes. It even has appearance at the time, comic shop owner, John Nunziata of St. Paul Comic, he makes an appearance in there dealing some books to the femme fatale, who is mostly unimpressed when they have him later killed. So, The original run only ran 10 issues, and then he has since come back in other forms, and there is a book you can buy if you can find it. And it was just one of those that I enjoyed reading. I mean, at the time, I was just, this was kind of my golden age for comics, so I was just absorbing everything. And this little gem from Kitchen Sink, I enjoyed the art, I enjoyed the story, and I was kind of sad to see it end. He did end it. I started a science fiction thing called Border Worlds, and I think it started as a crossover or extra in like number 6.
Yeah.
And then he went full Fletch in that. I don't recall much of Border Worlds other than the art was pretty cool. I do know when I actually met Don at one of the local comic shows, I asked him for a little sketch in my sketchbook. I said, could you maybe draw a picture of like somebody from Border Worlds holding a gun to a Megaton Man and asking him to quit? And he did. And it's really cool. Like I said, I'll make a copy of it sometime and post it online.
You're forgetting his most important work, Joe.
Well, but that wasn't fun. That was erotica.
Yeah, it wasn't erotica. You're forgetting Wendy Whitebread, Undercover Slut.
He drew Undercover Sluts very well. Like I said, it was
probably the most offensive comic I have ever read.
Not even more than Tales of the Leather Nun?
I never read that.
I'll borrow you my copy if I can.
No,
buy it.
That's okay.
Hey, it's underground. It's got to be good.
The book that I have that is still running started in 1982 or 3, Grew, by the aforementioned Sergio Aragonés. Grew is a... you could say it started as a Conan parody. Grew is the dumbest barbarian, and they have been doing it since then. We're over 30 years now. He has built up... Sergio does the comic. Mark Evanier writes the dialogue, kind of. And they're both really fuzzy about what Mark Evanier does, which is part of the joke. But they've built up this impressive universe of characters. It's Sergio's art is always funny and fun. And the stories are... You know, now they do mini-series. Each issue can be read on its own. I have never, ever read an issue of Grew where I wasn't entertained. And Sergio's a treasure. I know that I often say that I am a national treasure, because I am. But Sergio is also a national treasure. And anytime you get a No Sergio book, it's going to be great. If you haven't read Grew, what's your problem? Go get some Grew.
And while you're looking for Grew, pick up Mighty Mangor from Malibu, where Sergio and Evanier make a superhero comic. Although the thing is about the superhero Mangor, he speaks in comic book cliches. And of course, number one has a cool pop-up cover if you're into that type of thing.
One of the things that kind of bugs me is all these other books, Dark Horse has put out omnibuses, you know, 25. $25 booklets that are about 400 pages. They have not done it for Grew. If they did it for Grew, I would buy them in a heartbeat.
They really should.
The biggest one
of Grew, of course, was through Epic. I don't know how many issues they did through the Marvel imprint.
120.
120? And two graphic novels, and I mean, you got to look at it. Grew went to Pacific, they went out of business. Went to Eclipse, they went out of business. Went to Epic Marvel, Epic folded, Marvel went bankrupt. Went to Image, they collapsed. Dark Horse, they're still around. Yes,
now.
They lost Star Wars. I mean, wherever Grew goes, bad stuff happens. That's just Wizard. It was in Wizard, and. We know what happened to Wizard. Oh, well. The second one I chose is one I've talked about, but I haven't talked about it in a long time. Amazing Man from DC. And it was 1986 to 88. Bob Ozakis did the writing for all the issues. And then Stephen DeStefano, and again, I am really bad with names. He did the... art. And this is kind of, it could have been a cutesy, fluffy, satirical title, but it was actually kind of charming. The hero is Siegfried Horatio Hunch III, who runs around the neighborhood calling himself Amazing Man. He's just an ordinary but short guy who gets involved when others stand aside. And it might be a little crazy, but, you know, a hero's nothing without a supporting cast. And it was just a lot of fun. It lasted 12 issues. And they did a special edition in 87 and 88 and another in 90. But since then, I haven't seen much of anything of them. It's a fun little series. And again, these are ones you can pick out probably cheap out of the quarter bins because they're not super highly collectible, which probably makes them tougher to find.
I got to do one now?
I don't care what you got to do. I still got more.
Well, the next one I have is another comic that's been going for a long, long time. Joe and I have talked about it repeatedly. Knights of the Dinner Table.
Oh, good choice.
Knights of the Dinner Table started as a strip in a couple gaming magazines about role-playing game players. It then graduated to its own book and is now, what, over 200 and some issues. Still comes out monthly. It's half comic, half gaming magazine. And one of the things that's interesting to me about it started as gag strips. You know, everything was to set up the next joke. And over the last, I would say, 4 or 5 years, it's become more of a soap opera. Yes, there are still jokes. Yes, the situations are still silly. But the characters have real consequences and go through more emotion than just what it means to set up a joke. And there's been a maturing of the storytelling in it over the last few years that I really like. It's still funny. There's still a lot of jokes, especially if you've ever been somebody who plays role-playing games. But it's getting a deeper resonance as Jolly Blackburn seems to master the art and get older. So if you haven't read Knights of the Dinner Table, go pick up an issue. They're a lot of fun.
And you can pick up the older ones. I think they're called Tales from the Vault, where they run 4 issues in a square-bound format, but they're a couple years behind. Plus, Kenzer and Company has a wonderful digital program. If you want to download them all digitally and read them, the art's real basic, but you know we're raving about this. This is one of those where the story supersedes the art in many ways. Well, that makes it easy for me because I can cross that one off my list. Because I was going to choose that one too. But instead, I will go to Uncle Scrooge, which has been published by tons of different people. It's currently being published by IDW. But the ones that I prefer are the ones done by the masters, Carl Barks and Don Rosa. The current stuff that's being published are things that were published overseas. And I did try the IDW series and didn't like it as much. Because, again, when you... There was something about these two guys. I did not know who they were until later on because in my pre-collecting days, I would pick up Disney comics, and I really, really loved the Uncle Scrooge comics. And the other ones were kind of like, eh, meh. You know, there's Uncle Scrooge in this one and Mickey and Friends, but it's not the same. And I never understood why. It was because of the brilliance of their writing and the art. And so if any time I can find their stuff reprinted, it to me, that's the epitome of fun. I just enjoy the work that both of these guys will do, and I'll go out of my way to find books that have what they do. And again, I tried the current stuff. I forget the name of the artist and the writer doing it. It just does – oh, Romano Scarpa. And I believe this is stuff they're doing from Italy, isn't it? That was published there first, and this is the first time it's been over here?
I don't know if it's Italy or Norway, because I do know in the Scandinavian countries, the Disney comics sell insanely well. And Don Rosa has talked in the past a lot about how he had a whole career just doing comics for the Norwegian publishers. So, I like... Fantagraphics is reprinting both the Carl Barks stuff and the Don Rosa stuff.
I know.
And then IDW is printing the newer things.
So you got a choice of both.
The next series that I have is two series that Marvel are doing, because they're both fun, and but in different ways, and that's Ms. Marvel and Squirrel Girl. Ms. Marvel got a lot of press because the protagonist is a 15-year-old Muslim girl. I like it because it, again, harkens back to the early days of Marvel, where it's set in a high school, there's goofy adventures, the things aren't all serious and dramatic, and death is coming all the time. It's fun superhero adventure type stuff. Same with Squirrel Girl. Squirrel Girl's a little sillier because, well, okay, it's Squirrel Girl.
Undefeatable.
And if you read the comic, you do need to read the little notes at the bottom of each page.
I didn't do that the first couple issues, and then I had to go back and just reread them all.
So, but they're both set in the Marvel Universe. They're superhero stories, but they're goofy without being silly. They're fun without being stupid. I really enjoy them. I really look forward to them when they show up on Marvel Unlimited, because I know I like the big dramatic stuff. You know, I love the Jonathan Hickman, The Universe is in Peril. But I also like the, you know, our neighborhood's being gentrified, and looks like the person doing it might be a former supervillain. Or we've traveled back in time. We need to figure out how to get to our modern time without screwing things up. But, oh, hey, this is cool and fun.
Well, didn't she go out and have a tete with Galactus, and they went off to find him a planet he could eat on?
Yes.
I mean, Galactus basically talks to her like she's an equal. The undefeatable Squirrel Girl.
What's your next one, Joe?
This is one of those that it's being published, but not by the people that I'm bringing it to. I'm going to talk about the third series of Star Trek that DC did, but only specific ones, the ones that Peter David wrote, because Peter David had just a fantastic ear for dialogue. He had a lot of fun. Some people complain it's too glib, but I enjoyed it when he took over the Star Trek comic. There were things like he did the gag when, I forget the name of the security guy, and all you saw was his body from the shoulders down, taking the gag out of Police Academy and running with it. It's like, I love it when he takes point. The series was canceled quickly, I should say, just boom, and then it came back in a fourth series, and Peter David wrote it for a while. And again, the same thing, he brought back just some of the fun. He realized what a lot of people, including people who wrote the third season of Star Trek, forgot. You need a little bit of humor inside of Star Trek. Hey, even Roddenberry didn't like Trouble with Tribbles. It just, he was like, this isn't Star Trek. Star Trek's not supposed to be funny. But some of the best remembered episodes have that little tweak of humor, especially at the end. Peter did that. His first run in the original Star Trek was started from 48. And if you excuse me a minute while I...
excuse me while I whip this out.
Take a look at issue, the fourth one, which started in 89, and Peter David did it until issue 15. And the last three were interesting because they had what they call Return of the Worthy, written with Bill Mumy, which is the closest thing you're probably ever going to get for a Lost in Space Star Trek crossover. And Gordon Purcell did a lot of the art. James W. Fry III did some of the art. Another thing that happens here is the trial of James T. Kirk. If you got nothing else to read, just pick those up. You can always do the first couple ones before that because they send a bounty hunter named Sweeney. Not Sweeney! Not Sweeney! He's the one to go after Kirk. And he kind of reminds me a lot of John Cleese from Monty Python. Now he's able to bring Kirk in, and then at the trial, all of Kirk's sins against the Prime Directive come back to haunt him, especially when I can't think of the episode, the guys from the gangster planet show up. Hey, we understand that you Federation boys are giving Kirk the lowdown. Well, we're here to help him out. But we can bring the heat on too, you know. just fun stuff. I mean, I love Peter David's Star Trek writing, even into the Star Trek novels and books he used to write. I don't know if he's writing them anymore. I don't know what's going on in the book world. But check this one out, Star Trek 48 to the end, and then in the fourth series, issue 1 to about 15. Definitely worth your while.
Next one I have is a new comic, just started recently. Matter of fact, I think there may be only one issue out. Adam Hughes' Betty and Veronica.
Mm.
I like the new Archie, but the new Betty and Veronica is different. It's, well, first off, it's Adam Hughes' art.
Oh, yeah.
But he does the one thing that I wish more people would do with comics. He plays with the form. He will do things like, you know, they have a long conversation that's really kind of boring. So instead, here's Betty and Veronica in bikinis. Or, you know, hot dog narrating things. Just playing with the form of comics, not taking any of it seriously, but still telling a story and still building likable characters. Like I said, I really like Mark Waid's Archie. I think it's just a perfect updating. But Betty and Veronica is kind of like Ambush Bug to me in that, okay, we're set in this world, but we're going to play with it, we're going to have fun, and we're going to mess with things without breaking the toys. And it's Adam Hughes drawing pretty girls.
Oh.
Come on, man. Come on, man.
Not to mention, I believe,
come on.
What's her name? Cheryl Blossom coming in? So you're going to have yourself your redhead there. The fun thing I love about it is that they do tons of variant covers for every issue, all the same price. So you can pick and choose which variant cover you like most of all. I think the one I chose for issue 1 was his wife, Allison, the one that she did. And so no matter what you do, if you pre-order through previews or you just happen to run down to your favorite local comic book shop, you don't have to worry about one going higher than the other because they're all the same price. Speaking of breaking things, the last one I'm going to talk about is one I have talked about before, and I'll probably talk about it again because I tend to pull it down every couple of years and read it. Normal Man by Jim Valentino. Originally published through Aardvark, how do you say that?
Vanaheim.
And it was a 12-issue plus a 3D special. And this one really, if Normal Man basically is the only non-superhero on the planet, I can't even pronounce it right, Levram, which if you spell it backwards, you'll get the joke. Normal Man's father decides to shoot him into space because he thought that the planet would explode. It didn't, so naturally his wife kills him. But the son is placed in a rocket and it lands, on Levram, where everybody is a superhero. And so Jim basically skewers almost every single comic in existence at the time. And this came out in 84, 85. The first issue is a DC parody, second issue, Marvel, the third one, EC, the fourth one, ElfQuest, and so on, all the way through. It's a coherent story. It ties into things really well. You could almost call it a crossover comic, a big event comic before they were, you know, driven into the ground. And it also was published in a book by Slave Labor, if you can find it. And hopefully if anniversary's coming up, they'll maybe do a nice remastered hardcover for Image sometime. Because sometimes the Jim's detail in his writing gets so detailed that it's hard to read, you know, in the old black and white. But this one, again, is not highly – none of the ones I really talked about are highly collectible, with the exception of really, really early issues of Knights of the Dinner Table. So you should be able to find them just with some quick hunting on eBay or through the quarter boxes. The novel might be a little harder to reach, but I've got them, and I'm keeping them, so don't ask. Cory, what else you got on your list?
My last one is a TV tie-in book written by the people who do the TV series, and that is Rick and Morty. Rick and Morty is a series on Cartoon Network created by Dan Harmon, who also created Community, and it's about a dimension-hopping scientist and his nephew. No, grandson. It's his grandson. And it's filled with time travel and dimension travel and alternate universes and weird aliens. And I really can't describe it other than it's one of the stranger but more interesting TV series on today. A lot of people will watch an episode or two and kind of go, I don't know. But eventually it'll click for you. And once it clicks, you're like, oh, this is sheer brilliance. And the comic book is by one of the writers on the show, and he brings that knowledge to it, that sort of sense of humor. And pretty soon we'll have had more Rick and Morty comics than actual episodes of the TV show. If you like the TV show, you'll really enjoy the comic. If you don't know the TV show, just go over to Adult Swim's website. You can watch all the Adult Swim shows for free. Watch a few episodes, and then if it's your cup of tea, head on over and jump on it. You know what's not fun, Joe?
A cold cup of tea.
The fact that I have to go to the restroom, and I will be back in a couple of minutes.
Cool.
The show is yours.
I got nothing.
Yeah.
Although I will take this time to plug, I actually sat down this weekend and did the long-awaited Solo Joe episode that I promised with my old partner, Pat Gruber. And we sat down, and for a couple hours, we just talked and just kind of went chronologically through, our secret comic book origin and how we met and how we got together, and found some information out that I don't remember from when we formed Hot Comics, I should say. And Pat deciding to get out, me buying them out, me selling the shop, and so on and so on. It's going to take me a bit of time to edit this together, but it'll actually end up being two episodes. I'm going to cut them up into hour-long things. So I will have reached my goal of doing 4 monthly podcasts this year. If you remember, way back in January, I thought I would do one a month, and that was a little bit too much for me, but doing one a quarter seemed to work out, so I'll have 4 done. And then, of course, going into next year, I've got some other things planned. I am nowhere near the podcasting machine that Corey is, but I will try to keep it going and keep it entertaining, and I will talk a little bit more because I got myself a brand new computer, but I don't want to say too much because we got Freaking and Geeking coming out after we talk about our sponsors, which I'm sure Corey will talk about once he's finished diddling his doddle.
Or doodling his noodle.
Doodling your noodle?
So you got that going for you.
Give it a go. He's got that going for him.
Which is nice.
It's nice.
Oh, Chris is on the show?
No, she's just doing a drive-by.
That's good. It's good to do drive-bys. We need more drive-bys.
We do. Matter of fact, if you want to do a drive-by, Corey, do we got an email people could, make their own MP3s and we could plop it in the shop?
Why, yes, we do. It's solitairerosenetwork@gmail.com.
Cool.
See, we're all professional and stuff.
We're professional and
Where's
stuff.
Where's Holly?
She ran up to the gas station to get gas.
Walked up or drove up?
I don't know. Is my truck out front?
I didn't see it.
Then she probably drove. The gas station's only a block away, so you can see how far it is.
Well, she takes after you.
Whose money is she using to get gas is more the question.
I don't think she's going to get gas. She's just going to get food.
Oh.
Oh, well, gas station food, some of the healthiest food on the planet.
Oh, sure, gas. But she's taking after me. Gotta go get gas.
You know who doesn't need to get gas? Other than you.
These guys?
Our sponsors!
Yes, here at Solitaire Rose Networks, we have ads. That's right, we have ads. Just like every other podcast. Come on, it's okay. Our first advertiser is our longest running advertiser, and that's DreamHost.com. DreamHost.com is the best, bar none, web host all over the interwebs. You could go to other web hosts. You could go to the ones that have big ads on TV and everything, and they're not going to give you the service, the dependability, and the reliability of DreamHost. Head on over to DreamHost.com, use the code CRAZY, K-R-A-Y-Z, and get $20 off your first year of web hosting. Another of our sponsors is Dollar Shave Club. Dollar Shave Club has great blades at low prices, and let's face it, you gotta shave. Head over to shaved.by/C19DC, get you some blades, they're wonderful, I use them, I use all of our sponsors. Matter of fact, head on over to crazycomics.com. Over on the right-hand side of the page, you'll see all of our sponsors, Bombas, Grays, Flaviar, Dollar Shave Club, and DreamHost. If you would like to advertise on any of the podcasts in the Solitaire Rose Network, you can. Just email solitairerosenetwork@gmail.com, subject advertising. And after we do the ads, we ask Joe the same question every week.
We do?
Yes. Joe, are you wearing pants?
No, not till you go to a Comic-Con.
Joe will never wear pants.
Cory will never go to a Comic-Con. Maybe if we don't call it that.
Meh. No, we asked Joe, what's going on the eBays?
All sorts of fun things. Things are being relisted, repriced. I put a run of, I guess they call it the third series X-Men variants from 2010. I got a whole run of Tarzan ready to go, starting with the first DC issue. And, of course, that was all done with Joe Kubert art, so that's very cool stuff. And it, what was interesting is, of course, they continued the original numbering from the original Dell series. And we haven't done it in a while. Let's ask the Strode.
I was actually ready this time.
Good. Why did they do that?
Why did they do what?
Continue the original numbering for Tarzan of the Apes from Dell into the DC series.
Because at the time, this was before comic shops, and it was widely believed that a lower number meant lower sales. Higher numbers, the newsstand owners would go, oh, well, this has been around for, you know, 50 issues, 60 issues, 100 issues. They would give it better placement. The problem is DC's distribution was kind of wobbly at the time. So while DC had Tarzan, it was never a huge sales success like they wanted it to be. They eventually let the license lapse. There was another... they also weren't... The DC versions were not as popular overseas. Marvel got the license... And they actually made the people, the Edgar Rice Burroughs people, a little annoyed because Roy Thomas wanted to adapt the novels like he had done for Conan. And they said, well, no, DC just did that. And Roy Thomas would say, nobody read those. We're going to do them. We'll do them differently, et cetera, et cetera. So that when the contract came up, the Tarzan people just kind of did not renew with Marvel. And sales were so poor that Marvel didn't care.
Yeah, they went 72 to 77 DC, 207. Last issue was 258. They also did a bunch of 100-page giants, including a digest, and I think they did one in their 100-page spectacular. Marvels ran 77 to 79, 29 issues, and, of course, the ones that are really worth some money are those goofy 35-cent variants, which will, if you're lucky enough to find between one and issues one and five, tend to guide anywhere from 50 to 80 bucks if you can find them. Hang on a second. I just want to check to see if I've got them.
Joe's going to whip this out.
Curses. Only the rare, the unrare 30-cent variant. Sometimes you win, sometimes you lose. But again, if you're interested, these will be up probably by the time this podcast drops, and go to Crazy, K-R-A-Y-Z, and if you win something or you see something, you know, I've been known to give good deals to listeners of our show. I've been known to grab something off my vast accumulation of crap and just give it to you for free, or do something nice, you know, depending on how much pie Corey shares with me.
Did you just say you have crap?
What?
You said you have crap?
No, highly desirable collectibles.
That was close. Too close.
You need to watch your mouth, young man.
I might have to just lock that door. It's never happened when I was in the basement next to the Cyclotron 3000.
Oh, that's right. You're upstairs now.
I know.
People can step in. You could get guests at any moment.
Any moment I could have a run-in.
Think Butch will show up?
Not likely. We couldn't even talk to him. I don't know if he was in the shower.
Well, I don't even know if he still exists.
Well, I saw him at the con, so he did exist as of, you know, Fall Con. And I'm pretty sure, well, no, not going to do it yet.
Not going to do what yet?
Never mind.
Oh, okay. I thought you'd get that out of your system while I was gone.
Nope.
Well, now it's time for my favorite part of the show. No, not the end.
Oh.
It's freaking and geeking. Joe, what are you freaking on?
Well, now that you mention it, we all know that MSP Comic Con 2017 will be May 20th and 21st at the Minnesota State Fair Grandstand. And, of course, advance tickets will start going on sale January 1st at www.mcbacomics.com. But do you know who else is coming to town?
Santa Claus?
Nope.
Oh.
Wizard World's coming back.
Yeah, I saw that. They had announced that they weren't going to, and now they're saying they are. What a lie. No good.
May 6th, May 7th, and of course, we all know when that is. The first weekend in May, free comic book day.
Yeah, because they're doofuses.
Those bobo. Yeah, they just wonder why. You know, I don't know. I can't see why they're doing it at that day.
Because they're doofuses?
0 cents. But, you know, we'll see what happens as time goes on. Let's see, they got a list already of a bunch of people that I have no idea who they are. So, yeah, this one looks to be good. Well, it's early, and you don't know. But, yeah, they're going to come back, so we'll see. I don't think it'll affect the MCBA at all, because, as we know, Wizard World's a Hollywood-type show. You go to see people who are in science fiction movies and TV shows. MCBA works mostly just comic books, and it's more of a homegrown, old-fashioned type comic shop show. Heavily attended, I might add.
Yes, that's what I've heard.
Let's see, other freakings? Well, you know, I pretty much started my working Sundays, so I'll be getting that nice Sunday bling at work. 25% shift differential for working on Sundays, but I won't have any weekends off. And of course, as time goes on, I keep hearing about all these wonderful things going on weekends that I just won't get to do. Heavy sigh. That's pretty much it. I mean, other than that, not a lot of freaking. How about you, Corey? What you freaking on?
Joe, do you know how many hours I put in between my two jobs last week? Why don't 80, you guess?
80.
Higher.
70.
Higher.
90.
Higher.
100.
Higher.
200.
104.
104?
104.
That's all, no more?
And
they
then
show you the door? I bet you won't be poor. God, I need a s'more.
Here's the other thing. On Friday, I was already signed up to do, you know, all of these hours. And can you come in early when you get off work at your full-time job and everything? It's like, well, no, because then I'd be there 24 hours straight. Okay, well, can you stay on Sunday until 3? I'm already staying until 3. Oh, well, after you go home, we know you're doing the Sunday overnight. Could you come in about 5? No. But when I came in Sunday night, here's how short staffed they are. There were 3 staff working. They need to have 3 staff working. 2 of them were office staff who are not trained in working with the clients that we work with. So they were just able to do like laundry and cooking and cleaning up after dinner and everything. And the other staff, who was the supervisor, who normally doesn't work in the cottage either, had to do all the client care. So they are really, really shorthanded at the group home. Now, the good thing is that my check that comes on Friday, that's going to be nice. I'm going to enjoy that. The bad thing is that I was supposed to go see friends on Saturday night after I got done with my 17-hour shift. And I came home and I laid down on a couch. And about an hour after I laid down on the couch, I actually just sent them a text and said, and the text said, I am not getting off this couch until I have to go to work. Sorry, I will not make it tonight. So I'm exhausted. We are also in the middle of open enrollment at the full-time job, which is when people can call to change their benefits. So, going to be a busy few weeks here at the old Solitaire Rose Networks. Sadly, not because we're making tons of podcasts, even though we are making tons of podcasts, but because of the insane work schedule that I signed myself up for because I can't say no to money. Why can't I say no to money, Joe?
Because it's fun to spend.
But I never have time to spend it.
You do, too. You can just sit down and anytime you want, open up Amazon, eBay, or any of the other online merchants and get any of your highly desirable collectibles.
But I don't do that.
Yeah. And you haven't heard me talking a lot about things I bought on eBay recently. So
I did go to the grocery store and buy some food that we'll talk about in the geeking.
Sometimes when I go there, I like to just wander the cereal aisle and pretend I'm at Toys R Us playing toys.
The other thing I am freaking on, they did a variant for the new Iron Man comic that has a 15-year-old girl as Iron Man, and it was drawn by J. Scott Campbell. It was only going to be at, what is the name of the place in New York that you went to, Midway Comics?
Midtown.
Midtown Comics?
Yep.
And first off, people lost their minds because she was drawn as if she were, you know, a 22-year-old Playboy model.
Social justice warriors, unite!
Nah, that's, I always, whenever I hear that, it's like, yeah, whatever. I do agree.
Unite!
I do agree.
People with nothing else to do, protest!
That a 15-year-old girl should not have been drawn like a 22-year-old Playboy model.
Now, while I agree with that, having had two 15-year-old daughters, they like to dress that way.
Yes.
So they don't look that way.
So the fact that Marvel did
hopefully it... Hopefully don't look that way.
The fact that Marvel did it, kind of annoying. The fact that people got all pissy about it, as annoying.
More annoying.
The people who got pissy about the people who got pissy about it, even more annoying.
That's me. Actually, I didn't. I was kind of like, whatever. I've seen it before. You got mad at the teenage... Power Girls, you got mad at the Spider-Woman butt shot. But Frank Cho's out there somewhere. You know he'll respond, maybe.
Dear Marvel, please, remember, you're doing these things to get a broader audience.
We're not talking girl broad. We're talking, you know, all ages.
Wider.
All sexes.
So please do not have your artist draw your 15-year-old girls like they're porn models, okay? I don't mind if the adult characters are drawn in very sexualized way, but 15-year-old girls, you're getting really creepy, okay? It's kind of creepy. It's kind of Donald Trump creepy, okay? And just the whole everybody seems to be looking for a reason to be mad at someone and a plague on both your houses. The people who live to get mad about this stuff and the people who live to get mad about the people who get mad about this stuff. They're fucking funny books, okay? And guess what? I'm going to give you a secret. If you ignore it for a month, it goes away. Because this is a book that maybe will sell 100 copies. You put it up on eBay a year from now, and no one will care. All right? Just let it go. Just let it go. Geeking. Joe, what are you geeking on?
Let's take a look. Well, the first thing I talked about when you were at the bathroom, so you'll have to go back and listen to it since I don't want to bore our listeners a second time with it. Number two, I got the Kraytronic 6000 up and running, and it seems to be working wonderfully. We haven't had an internet blip. I haven't had a computer freeze other than my own fumbly fingers. The weird thing about it, I did decide to go with a desktop. Let's see if I've got the model. I went with a Dell XPS 9800, which is probably I figured, you know, this might be one of the few computers I buy before I move. I don't know. Being that the other one lasted me 7 years, this one should last me hopefully to the end of the decade. It's got plenty of room to expand, put in memory any other goofy device that comes along, like these here solid-state drives they were showing off at Best Buy. Did not come with speakers, which was, well, I knew that when I got it. So I went out and bought me a pair of Logistics 323 with a nice subwoofer thing. I was going to go buy something cheap, but I thought, you know, I may actually end up watching internet TV or watching some DVDs on this because, you know, usually I get home and, like, Chris has our TV in the bedroom. She's watching it. Holly's watching her show in the living room. So I got nothing to watch, but now I can do it on my super television, on my supercomputer. So, well, I can't wait to see. Corey and I did have a brief hiccup when we first started because apparently the version of previews that comes with it, what was it, Skype preview, did not want to cooperate. Could not hear Corey. He kept calling. I heard no ringing. I heard no, you know, when I answered, I heard nothing. So I deleted it, just downloaded a regular version. And through the magic interwebs, tubes and wires we call internet, here we are podcasting for your amusement. In terms of reading, I read a lot, but they were just big books. You know, I've been slowly going through Bloom County. I'm in volume 3 right now, the 4 volumes, and then, of course, there's Outland and Opus, which I don't have yet. I did take a detour and off of Amazon get me a copy of Academia Waltz. That was the original strip that, I can always say his name.
Burke Breathed.
Burke Breathed, thank you. His college strip, and it's a lot more less politically correct because it was college stuff. He doesn't do as much annotating as I would like, you know, and a lot of it is things you'd have to think would mean something to somebody going to the University of Texas or where the hell he was going. A lot of the stuff you read, he recycles in Bloom County, and he, you know, he admits that. But it was just a fun read, kind of a neat part of the collection to add to it. It is an IDW book. I do not recall it ever being offered in previews, but there are plenty of copies around eBay and Amazon. So if you want to pick a copy up and see what his pre-Bloom County stuff was like, it's a lot of fun. The other thing I did is I ran across my old series Love and Capes by Thomas Zahler. I picked up book 2, 3, and 4 cheap at the past MCBA con. I have book 1 in my collection. Usually the ones at 2 through 4 I have as regular comics, but I figured, you know, these are just fun reading books, and to have them in book form is nice because now I can just pull them down whenever I want. I don't have to go run into my collection, figure out where they are. I know they're all together, but just trying to pull them all out, take them out of the bags, read through them. So I thought I was just going to take my time reading through them, and once I started, I just ripped through all 4 of them. And I don't know if he's ever planning on revisiting these characters. Love and Capes is something I recommend for anybody who has ever liked superhero comics. He takes, of course, the arch Superman, Wonder Woman, Batman type, and, you know, heck, if we had him write a regular Superman, Lois and Clark type series, I think he would do a much better job than anybody else because it was written as a sitcom, wasn't it? That's what he was thinking originally?
Yes.
And it's web-based, so you can look up Love and Capes and check a few columns out or strips out, see if it's your cup of tea, and then if you like it, I have no idea if these are still available through IDW, but if not, we live in a wonderful age of Amazon and eBay, so check it out. And that was pretty much it. Corey, what are you geeking on? What's got you happy?
The season premiere of Walking Dead arrived last night, a week and a day
ago. Speaking of the internet flipping its gourd.
And it was better than issue 100 of Walking Dead. And issue 100 of Walking Dead, well, first off, if anybody remembers issue 100 of Walking Dead, pissed people off and there was a lot of, I'm not reading this book anymore. Never mind the fact that it continues to grow in sales every month. But this is not just a zombie show. This is a show that gets into deeper moral quandaries. This is a show with some amazing acting. But as I'm watching it and then hearing the reaction, it reminds me of the reaction people have to the comic, which I've said before. The comic will have periods of relative calm as it builds up to the really horrific shit that's going to happen. Well, that's kind of what has happened with the show. They had some episodes where, you know, things happened that weren't, you know, they were tense, but they weren't horrific. And then they pulled the rug out from under you and reminded you that this is a horror TV show. This is not a happy show. This is not about a bunch of plucky survivors beats up on zombies. But it's also, it's horror. In horror, anyone can die at any time. And the other thing is that I think one of the reasons it makes people so uncomfortable is because it plays out these moral quandaries in a way without giving you an answer, where you think that you're watching the heroes, but if you look at it from another point of view, they're pretty horrible, terrible people. And the complexity of that and the way they do that, I think, is one of the best shows on TV. Comic-wise, I caught up on Jason Aaron's Thor, basically starting from the first issue of the female Thor from about a year and a half ago to now. Holy crap, this is good! You've got a war within the realms. He is using the Ten Realms more than anyone else, including a war between the light and the dark elves. He's doing the cliche of Odin being a complete jackass, but playing it out differently, so it's not just Odin's throwing a fit. It's, nope, Odin is a tyrant. And how do the gods of Asgard deal with the fact that Odin has become a tyrant when while he was gone, they actually set up a system of government? And he has come in, and they're actually using some of the stuff from Fear Itself. And I remember reading Fear Itself going, this is stupid. I hope they never use it again. But Jason Aaron has actually picked up the threads of that and turned it into something very, very cool. If you are not reading Thor, grab your Marvel Unlimited, grab those trade paperbacks, start with the first issue of the first female Thor, forward. Holy crap, this is good. And I liked Malekith under Walt Simonson, who created the character. Malekith is now my favorite villain in the Marvel Universe. Because he's sneaky, he's evil, and he's thinking long-term. Kind of like what Thanos did when Jim Starlin wrote him, where Thanos isn't just, I am a bad guy and I will do bad things. It's, no, he's got a plan. And even if the heroes win, it doesn't stop the plan. So, I really like that sort of stuff. It shows that the writer is thinking. Turner Classic Movies has been showing a lot of the Hammer horror films, including all of the Christopher Lee Dracula movies, except for the last one, back to back. There is nothing better in my mind. You know, a lot of people love the Universal horror movies, you know, the Frankenstein, Bride of Frankenstein, Dracula, Son of Dracula, those. For me, it was the Hammer films, because they were the ones being shown late night when I was a kid. The Scars of Dracula, Taste the Blood, Frankenstein Must Be Destroyed, all of those, you know, Peter Cushing, Christopher Lee, and Turner Classic has the best prints. So these are pristine prints in glorious high definition. This is what Halloween is supposed to be, by God. The only one they did not show is the one that I have seen once. And I do think everybody who likes Christopher Lee needs to see this movie. It's not any good. In any way, shape, or form, it's not any good. But Dracula and the Seven Golden Vampires, which was a co-production of Hammer Films and the Shaw Brothers. That's right, Dracula takes on seven kung fu vampires. Oh, 70s.
If it was anybody else but Chris, I would worry. But
oh, you should worry anyway. Oh, 70s. it is amazing in how just not good it is. It's kind of like when they show the movie Skidoo, which was Jackie Gleason, directed by Otto Preminger, was Groucho Marx's last role. You need to watch it. And when I brought it over to my friend Tommy's house for one of our late night movie watchings, he said, "Oh, I've heard about this. I've heard it isn't any good." And I said, "You're right, it isn't. You've got to watch it. It's a glorious train wreck of a movie." I need to dig that out. Sadly, I only have it on VHS. I don't think they have put it on DVD legally yet. And the last thing is that by the time everybody listens to this, I will have gotten a paycheck, where at my part-time job, I had 35 hours of overtime. What am I going to do with the money? I went to the store. I bought the brand name cereal. And I didn't just buy the brand name cereal. I bought the big boxes. So when I bought Honeycomb, I bought the big goddamn box of Honeycomb. But Joe,
Corey's at the Honeycomb hideout.
Joe, remember when we used to do American food? Where we would bring up some of the more bizarre things that Americans eat. Mm-hmm. We've talked about the A&W root beer Pop-Tarts. We've talked about the Orange Crush Pop-Tarts. By the way, both of those are now available at Cub Foods.
And Crush was terrible.
They have maple bacon Pop-Tarts.
You know, I'm going to have to start trying to grow my own Pop-Tarts.
Now, I'm a little worried that the bacon may go bad, because Pop-Tarts are good for what, like 40 years? I don't think Pop-Tarts ever go bad. But there's maple bacon. I did not look to see if it was actual bacon or just bacon flavor. I thought I would leave that to you. But yes, there are maple bacon Pop-Tarts and watermelon Pop-Tarts. I have stunned him into silence.
I'm working, you know, taste memory into my mouth, trying to figure out if it's worth hunting down or just ignoring it till it goes away.
They're on Amazon.
Nah, they definitely ignore it.
Oh, then I may buy them and feed them to you.
Yeah, you can't. You want them on Pop-Tarts.
I wonder if they have meatloaf Pop-Tarts for Butch. We have now, has Golden Corral opened in the Twin Cities yet?
Nope.
We have to find a buffet to take Butch to, because I want him to destroy another meatloaf.
Yeah, Pizza Ranch. I don't think they have pizza.
They don't have meatloaf.
But they'll do any Pop-Tart you like. They won't do that.
Oh, they probably will.
I suggested enough.
Well, kids, believe it or not, you've listened to us blather on about funny books for an hour and a half.
It would have been less, but, you know, Corey had to take a bathroom break.
And as we say every week, the comic we like the least, we still like better than the comic that you like the most. Joe?
Corey, you matter. Unless you multiply yourself by the speed of light, then you energy. Hit my music!
We done, bitches!